and maybe not so you could benefit from this sort of introduction. I looked at the overall theme of this evening, and it was an introduction to data science. So I thought, let's keep it in this introduction. Okay, so no specific qualifications, I must say, from the start. So computer scientists, mathematicians, biologists, physicists, historians, anyone can be a data scientist. So that's the good news. Okay? So just in case somebody was feeling left out when we spoke about math, statistics, and what was the other one? Computer science. You're not left out. Okay. So, and for me, the way I look at it, if you have a team of data scientists, you're better off having people having different backgrounds. It works better than having people who think the same way. Okay, so if you only have engineers, you know, you miss out a lot from brilliant ideas that could come from an architect. Okay? So, but critical is four things. You don't need a degree or anything, any qualification in these things. Okay? I think you need more of interest, you know, just the energy, enthusiasm to wrap your head around, you know, data and problem solving. Then you get around this. But you need basic understanding. Okay? Basic understanding of mathematics and statistics. Okay, or statistics. Okay, strictly speaking, statistics. But there are certain models in certain areas which are more complex than, you know, statistics would handle. So maybe those would be better handled by an applied mathematician or a pure mathematician. So that's why I put both of them there. So the understanding of statistics and mathematics mainly frames your mind to be able to do proper model development. Okay? So that's basically why you need that understanding. Computer science is a wrong phrase there to actually use. What you need is basically an understanding of how to source data and manipulate, if I can put it simply. I put computer science there because some problems may become too complex that an understanding of how data sitting in different on different servers, you know, can be brought together, data coming at a certain speed, okay, velocity, remember we spoke about, can be better handled in good time for a decision, for example, to be made. So again, like I said, you don't need to be qualified in that, because you can't be qualified in all of them, right? Okay, well, you can, like Robert Mugabe. Yeah, but I think we get the point, right? Then you need some appreciation of the problem domain. So the domain that you'll be working in. So as a data scientist, the better you understand the domain of the problem that you're trying to solve for, you know, the better positions you are actually to solve that problem. Okay, so you need at least some appreciation. And the fourth area is just to understand how to tell a story. Okay? Understand who your audience is and how you can then position what the data is actually telling them. Because data is just data. Okay? Data science then looks at deriving insights out of the data. But insights that are not well presented, you know, as good as no insights at all sometimes. So you need to be very good at telling the story that the data is actually telling you. It makes a whole world of a difference if you can get that right. You can actually get some of those things wrong, but if you can tell a story in a good way, it actually puts you in a good space. So that's my presentation. I hope I'm having to overshot so much, yeah? I think right on time.
Well, now for questions after Chancellor Hughes'
presentation. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Christian, say a round of applause. My name is Tan Sakawa, and I'm with a startup called Rebasi Technologies doing some building an AI assistant for researchers. So my short presentation is on using data to understand customer behavior. So what I was thinking about when coming up with what to present was, why do we need to understand customer behavior? And it occurred to me it actually is simple, because, for example, so they have said something like, because you don't want to end up selling the wrong stuff to your usual customers, right? I think it's quite valuable to understand the patterns and the behavior of our customers. I think it's quite important to understand the patterns and the behavior of our customers. Especially when we're trying to build a product for people to use, because those people who are going to use that have got certain likes and dislikes for different kinds of products. So what that means, like for a startup, or like you're trying to bring a new product to the market, you don't want to just bring something based on assumptions only, right? Because what you end up finding is that you build you spend a lot of resources trying to build something, and then end up with no one to actually use that product. And that's very vital for startups. And in established companies, you find that understanding customer behavior is very vital to create a relationship with the customers. When you talk about retention, at the beginning, when mobile networks started coming in Zambia, most of us started with, there's been many changes, but most of us started with Telecel, Celtel, now Airtel, and MTN. There's MTN and the others. But what we usually find is that these guys, we move from one product to another. Why is it like that? Because our service providers occasionally don't build, we don't have a relationship with those service providers, because they are focused on selling us something, and yet what they are selling us is usually not exactly what we want or how we want it to be done. So understanding the behavior of customers helps us. It helps us create relationships with customers. There was a time we were doing some analysis on
change customers, like those customers who are no longer using the network when I was at Vodafone last year. And we found that we usually found that there are certain customers who would come in and buy some certain type of bundle or some certain type of data, and then all of a sudden you just find that every time when they buy, they usually when they buy a bundle, after some time you find that they stop being active on the network within the month, and then again they will come back like that. And then there are some who could buy the same bundle over and over and over. And what was interesting is that we ended up finding that some of those customers who were actually quite active and were buying bundles quite often would like just stop using the network. And you would wonder why. And what we discovered is that there was a point at which the offers that we were giving them were not exactly what they wanted. So there were attempts to provide different offers to actually bring back those customers. And in some cases they worked, in some cases they didn't, but that's the relationship with customers. So in order to do that kind of analysis, for example, we had to dig into the data and usually you collect a lot of data, and as the fintechs may perhaps already know, some of them are already collecting data and are saying they are not sure how to use it, and some are already using that data. But as my colleague mentioned earlier, it walked us through the process. It talked of collection. So the process involves data collection, storage and warehousing, normalization and visualization. So in data collection, it is actually very important to collect the right kind of data. You don't want to collect you don't want to collect data that you are not going to use, right? Because space is limited. If you are using your own computers or your own servers, you'll find you've got limited space. If you're using cloud services as well, each terabyte or each GB is a cost. So that becomes an expense on your business, which you don't want to do. So it is important you stick to a limited feature set of data, but it has to enclose a scope large enough to solve most of your problems. So, and when you collect data, you store it in a data warehouse, which has to be managed properly. Managing data can be a really, really big problem. Because we can be collecting data, and for most day-to-day operations, most people, I remember at Vodafone we used to collect like hundreds of GBs every day, which are the transactions, like how people are using that data. Now, if you don't clean up that data and it's not in proper order, it becomes a lot of headache for analysts. Like they can't do anything anymore with the data. It just becomes a mess. So it's very important to to use a proper warehouse facility, and there are quite a number of them you can find, like Amazon Redshift, and there are many others out there. So now, after you've collected the data and you've backed it up in a warehouse, the next thing before you use the data, like I've seen cases where some people have not done this before. Like, they get the data and just start applying their technical analysis, their whatever kind of complicated algorithms that they decide to apply before normalizing the data. Because if you're getting data from multiple sources, chances are very high that all that data will be very different from one another. If you're collecting data about shoe sizes, if you're running fashion thingy, collect data about shoe sizes of your customers, which type of shoe is being bought more often, and then if you are doing customer profiling, you also get their heights. So you say height to shoe size thingy. Those are, for example, those are two very different quantities. Like, the height is obviously much higher, much bigger than the size of the shoe, right? So before you can actually apply that data to your analytics, you have to normalize and bring them both to the same scale so that you can actually make sense out of that data. So it's important to keep it that way. So before you go on to apply your algorithms after your normalization and everything, it's quite useful to visualize the data. Like, there are some things you can point out, like selecting what features to use, right? There are some things that you can actually pick out using your own sight, because it's one of the most powerful computing computers that biology has ever created, which is the sight. So using visualization, you're able to tell, okay, which one is going to be more important? Should I focus on the sizes? Like, how does the height compare to the buying patterns of my customers? Right? So when you visualize that data, that's when you're going to see that, okay, I can use this feature and I can use this feature because they kind of look different and they would be useful. So after the visualization, that's when you can start applying the appropriate type of analysis. So this is before you decide which technique you're going to use. So you have to decide, what type of analysis am I going to use? Am I going to use a segment analysis? Is it a cluster or a cohort analysis? So depending on what you want at the end of the day, you decide which type of analysis to use. So, yeah. And when you've decided which type of analysis you use, you can then pick the appropriate techniques for the type of analysis. So if you're doing things like multivariate analysis, you have to use a technique that supports that kind of analysis. If you are going by segment or your customer segment, you decide to use a technique that would help you analyze that segment. And these techniques are not standalone. Right? It's actually always better to use multiple techniques. You'll find that sometimes, because there are different techniques and they require different type of resources, when you start solving a problem, when you start applying these techniques, sometimes you may find that even the simplest of models, like linear regression, or logistic regression work for that type of problem, and they'll give you the insight you needed. So they would save you time on using a more complicated problem and save you a lot of computing power or computational resources as opposed to using a more complicated technique. So after you've done your analysis, it is from there you have to take action, right? So you just don't do your analysis and throw it in the bag. So from that point, you have to take action. You have to see if what you did with your numbers actually makes sense out there with your customers. So I've given like three examples. These are screenshots from my phone. So after looking at these SMSs, I started thinking that they send me these SMSs because they do collect data about me. And recently I've noticed the first one from MTN. It says enjoy 1,008 minutes for 60 kwacha. So it's like they've noticed that I've been talking a lot on the phone. So they decided to send me that, because I don't use that. And yeah, so these are examples of how you engage the customers after you've analyzed. So you've analyzed that this is what they're doing, so they're quite likely to like this kind of product of ours, right? So engage with the customers at the end of the day. So you send them an offer through SMS, it can be a phone call. I remember there was a time we used to receive a lot of phone calls from service providers. Yeah. So, that's the end of my presentation.
The algorithm that you use for machine learning is, of course, the SVM, the logistic regression that you've spoken about. Of course, there's determining and deep learning. So, how does one determine which model to use, considering the fact that, okay, they've got this amount of data which is large, and then if I employ deep learning, of course, it will require me to use maybe a GPU, which I think you'd agree with me that. To some certain extent, these computers right now cannot handle the processing power of deep learning. So, how does one determine which algorithm to use given X amount of data?
Okay, so that depends on.
Catholic can also answer. You are free to answer as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Stand this.
Okay. So. Okay. That the algorithm mostly depends on what you're trying to solve, like even to what accuracy you want to go to, right? So there's a point where if you have enough data, almost every choice that you make of the algorithm will give you an almost exact, or almost precisely the same answer to a certain degree. So at that point, it wouldn't make a difference. But there are some points where the errors are just so different. Like this one gives you 20% error, the other one gives you 10% error, right? So you go for the one that gives you less error. So how you choose is you try multiple algorithms, right? And if you can see from small models that there are differences there, then you can pick the best one for a problem.
Yeah, so just to add on, most of the time the technique is dependent on the data. Okay, the structure of the data. That's what my colleague also did present, that if you can have a view even before you begin to analyze, it will normally inform, you know, what kind of tools or which model to actually go for. So I think, like I had said earlier on, the if you plot just a scatter plot, for example, okay, of data, just a scatter plot, a simple scatter plot, you can already see how that data is dispersed or distributed. So if you look at it in two dimensions, you can see what it is. In multiple dimensions, you can actually also see what it is. So if it looks like a straight line, then you know that you can actually use simple linear regression, and you can avoid the headache of trying more complex techniques, because your linear regression would already work. So it normally helps practically to have a view of the data, whether it's mapping the data. If you have to look at where the buses are in Lusaka across, you can actually do that. There are solutions around how you can do that, some GIS mapping tools. So I think in a nutshell, you just need to have an appreciation, first of all, of the domain that you're working in and the type of data that is coming through. So let's say there's a lot of seasonality around the data that is being produced, then you know that you must apply time series analysis. So, yeah.
The thing was based on, I was coming from a background where, you know, they're dealing with an IoT application which keeps generating data like every second. Every second is generating data. So
Internet of Things.
Yeah.
IoT.
So you might maybe apply let's say logistic regression, then for small data it's performing well. But then as the amount of data increases, then the model starts performing bad, and then let's say you deploy the application. So yeah. I was looking at it from that perspective.
Yeah. So well, depending on how, whether it's something that you will leave to operate on its own or something that you must constantly intervene and improve. Remember, like I had said earlier on, you know, the life cycle itself is iterative. Okay? So if data changes significantly, the model actually will become wrong. So then maybe you might need to revisit the model. So if it's constantly changing, then maybe you need to build in more complex learning algorithms. Especially if it's, for example, a robot that must sort of respond to things that you may not anticipate, then you must sort of allow it to the flexibility to learn new ways of solving its own problems. Yeah, because then it's changing. So again, if your solution is a simple one, whereby as a data scientist you have the leverage to monitor what is happening, and I'm just trying to accommodate everybody. If as a data scientist you have the leverage of monitoring the results of how the model is performing, you may want to then can produce the correct results. Okay? Then chances are that your model was built using adequate data. If it's producing wrong results, the techniques were right, but it's producing wrong results, chances are that you built the model using insufficient data. Let's say, for example, you're building a model around the price of maize, okay? On the commodity market, and you only have data from January to June, okay, chances are that you will get it wrong. So it may work for some time, But when you know, because the price of maize is seasonal, at some point it will fail. So maybe in a nutshell, like I said initially, for a number of problems, you normally split the data in such a way that you've got a training set and you've got a set that you use for testing. Okay, so if you've tested and you've applied the modeling correctly and it cannot reproduce the data, then chances are that the sample, if you like, was too small. If you grow the sample and it still fails, or you use the entire data set and it still fails, chances are that you don't have enough data.
Yeah, I think you said most of the things. The other thing I can say is, if you're actually building a model, one of the ways you can tell is that you have enough data is when your model stops improving. Yeah. So initially there is only a guess. Yeah. So you usually start with a guess. Yeah. But when your model stops improving, then you can say that you have enough data for that.
So my question is from a business intelligence perspective. I heard you say that the data is, the objective determines how the data is analyzed, right? So is the data that's being analyzed only able to produce insights from the objective, or can it also show other patterns that may not have been the focus of the analysis or the objective?
Yeah, and that happens a lot. Yeah. So especially when you do visualization, you tend to see things that you are not actually anticipating. And that's why visualization is very important before doing analysis and afterwards. Because it tells you more than just what the model.
Yeah, just to add on, data normally knows a lot more than we do, if I may say that. So, and I think that's a useful approach to have, to allow the data dictate how you're going to end up, like where you're going to end up. Because if you close your mind to say, this was my initial problem, that's the only thing that you will learn from the data. Okay? But if you are open-minded, the data will actually teach you a lot more things. I forget the name of the guy who said, if you torture the data long enough, it will confess to anything. So the more actually you look at the data, the same data, look at it today, look at it tomorrow, you can derive different insights.
Yeah. My question is, so both of you are interested in, so if I use the term a bit loosely, like different genres of data, even to, I think, financial sort of data, even to consumer interaction sort of data. So in Zambia, from both of your perspective, which type of or genre of data do you think is not yet tapped or is in abundance?
Yeah, you have to go first.
That's a very good question. Mostly you can only know about the things that you work with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but in 2016 there was a climate action hackathon in Livingston. I don't know if there's people who went to that thing. Yeah. And there what we found was that, like my friend that one asked about weather, what we found is that the way that data that is collected, for example, in Zambia, is usually limited in scope, like it doesn't capture a lot of other variables, and then it's only collected in parts, like usually at airports. So I know most airstrips there is instrumentation for getting weather data, and also at the Goma lakes, at Ponza or somewhere else, there's also some instrumentation. So I didn't talk about the climate or weather data. It's not enough, because even the most of the resources we were using for the data from that side was external. That it wasn't local. So it wasn't something like that.
Yeah. Just to add on, well, I think it's we have a journey. If you talk about data maturity and just access to data, we still have quite a bit of work to do as a country. But that, I think, is changing quite rapidly in terms of just the data that is there. As more and more, for example, people get involved in the digital space, there's much more data that can actually be used. Certain things like, for example, the city of Lusaka, for you to understand, you know, a number of things, you find that there will be limitations because they're not yet digitized. Okay? You can make guesses. For example, how do you even understand which one is the busiest route for buses, for example? Okay, that information may not exist at the moment. But that said, you still have, you know, pockets of information that can still be used from different sources. So depending on what problem you're trying to solve, you should be able to get some access to sizable data sets. Some data is still proprietary, if I can say, so sort of closed in terms of how much of that data you can access if you're not inside a certain system. So I think for that kind of data, we still have some limitations. So, but in the spirit of keeping things simple, focusing on the problem and the domain, there's always some data that you can work with. It may not amount to big data, right? It may be small data, but then you can still derive some insights out of it. It's about how you tell the story and how you eventually utilize that those insights. Two more questions?
Two last questions.
Good chance to ask.
Kind of adds to this question a bit. We talk a lot about data. We haven't talked about access to data much, even if it exists, which is, like, I believe, the major question. Every data scientist who isn't employed by a firm or a company that is actually collecting the data itself. I mean, this is an innovation, evening for young startups as well. So how do you actually access, how do you gather the data that might be interesting, and how do you access it?
So that's a good question. You know, I wish I had a very straightforward answer for it, but like I said, and to your point, you know, the good amount of data that you may need access to may actually be closed and proprietary. So I think for certain organizations, it's about having the engagements if you need to have access to that information. You succeed in some cases, some cases you want, and I'm trying to be very practical. But to my earlier point, I think it's a journey. But before we get to the ideal place that we would want to get to, the question is, how do we use data sources that are readily available? Can we actually get insights into data that's coming from, you know, social media, that's coming from the internet, okay, or data that is in the public domain, in the Central Statistical Office, you know, from other organs that may have data that could be open in terms of access to everyone. You know, again, I wish I would have a very positive, good, you know, attractive, whatever you may call it, response. But I think we can try, we can engage, but where we cannot get access to preparatory data is about how do we use what is readily available. We may not get it perfect. And in my job, I've learned sometimes to work with what I have. Okay? Because I work for a bank. I may not have information for other banks. And then I need to do competitive intelligence. Okay? So how do I get around that? So by using what is readily available, and then seeing how that is applied.
Is it the second question?
We have the last one.
Yeah.
Okay. Mine is almost similar to this. I just want to find out for startups. I'm sort of new to this conversation, but I'm really interested in how to use this data and how to provide this data. So I wanted to find out from Chancellor, which online platform would you recommend? You know, I heard you talking about warehousing, okay? For most startups, and I'm sure almost everybody here will probably start with a spreadsheet when they collect data, and they'll click save, and they'll put that data on a flash. And as business grows, you know, that database would also start to grow, and as interaction, you know, as we interact, you know, we want, this data becomes gold to us. You know, you carry it around on your laptop, but you're just a startup. You know, your startup won't really be at a physical location, one physical location, where you can't probably afford servers and all that. So my question is, what's the best online platform probably you recommend to store this data? You know, maybe for it to be safe till you can find a better platform or resource to actually put it out there for, you know, for other people to access. For example, the way we have data out on Facebook, how easily Google, I'll be thinking about something, then I'll probably I'll Google Bongo Hive, okay? Then I'll go on my Facebook page. I know whatever I was doing on the internet, probably cookies and whatnot. So I'll go to Facebook. And as I browse my Facebook page, the next thing that will pop up is Bongo Hive this, Bongo Hive that. And that's because I searched somewhere, so there was a linkage there. So what's the best platform you'd advise startups to warehouse the data?
Usually for startups, I think the best thing is to, like, you don't go, unless you are data oriented or data analytics startups, if you are a consumer oriented startup, keep as little data as you can, right? Because data is expensive, like to keep, whichever platform you use. But if you have to keep data, any online cloud storage facility would be sufficient, provided it meets your needs. And as a startup, I think cost is one of the most important things. Yeah. Excel spreadsheets or Google documents, that's not a very good idea, because they can get lost, right? And we're trying to build a customer base. So if that gets lost or corrupt, it means your information about the users will also be corrupt, and you won't be able to tell what is happening with your users.
And we end there, I have another answer for that. So we have a partnership with AWS, Amazon Web Services, which that was the second one.
Can you just add on something?
Okay, you want to answer, okay, yes.
Oh, yeah, like I'm saying, like most of the companies, like in Zambia here, they used to be right, to pick their name, they used to be right, okay? That's what I want to say.
Can I answer as well?
You wanted to answer as well?
Yeah, you should try out Box Scripter, which encrypts the data at the same time it saves. It's a little bit, it's not very expensive, I'm not so sure how much it is, but then it's highly recommended. You can keep as much information you want here, and then you're sure you can access it from anywhere. And then you won't lose it, and then you won't cut on the out. And then it's the security is very tight in terms of that. So yeah, Box Scripter is one thing that you should look at.
Box what?
Box Scripter.
And to sum it up, so I have a partnership with AWS, Amazon Web Services, a 2-year free membership. So if you're a startup that really wants to work with data, you can get Amazon Web Services for free for 2 years, and all the perks are in there as well. Yes, just talk to the next session. Okay, now we've come to another important part of the session where we need to pair fellows with fintechs. So it's very straightforward. Each fintech just comes up and talks a bit about themselves for less than a minute, basically the name, what you do, and hopefully that is enough information for other people to, you know, to understand your business. And then after that, as we are grabbing some food, we can talk to each other, and then we have a list at the back there which we put outside, where you can write down your names in case you're interested in that business. Just I need to mention, are there fintechs that are not taking in fellows? I know that was very specific. Or you're all taking in fellows? Okay, good. So I'll just call everyone up one by one though. Let's start with Altos now. Just tell us a bit about what you do under 1 minute. No stories, you won what award, 1 minute.
My name is Chisepo. We have a product called ZPOS that we use to help shop owners keep track of inventory. So instead of a micro merchant recording their sales using pen and paper, we can use our app, and our app will tell them information about their business, such as what inventory is running low, what inventory is left in their shop, what profit did they make from their sales, and much more. So using this information, we can now approach FSPs that can provide those micro merchants with loans, determine which micro merchant deserves a loan or not. That's what we do.
Awesome.
Yes, clap.
Zed Credit.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tundwa Siwo. I'm from Zed Credit. So Zed Credit is a platform that matches borrowers to lenders and digitizes records for savings group members so as to build their credit worthiness to get access to further funding and other microservices.
Afforded loans.
Hello, everyone. I'm Chisago.
And afforded loans, as the name suggests, we provide personal loans. The main idea of afforded loans is to use technology to provide financial services. So for example, one of the problems is that in Zambia, every person is given a blanket credit score. So everyone gets the same interest rate. So what we try to do is provide different interest rates based on someone's credit characteristics, that needs to pay back, where they work, how long they've been working there for, etc.
Good. Proverbs.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Chinedu Kobo Probes. It's a bit difficult to pin us to one particular product, but largely what Probes does is it has several payment collection platforms for NAPSA, taxes, and soon to be tolls. And what that does is typically across the bank infrastructure, especially with regards to customers being able to make payments from their accounts. We're able to track certain payment characteristics, which of course we can then take actionable actions around to determine probably is there any other product characteristic that the customer might be interested in. Thank you.
Champa Crispina, my name's. At Avention, we are business consultants. We offer business solutions and IT solutions. From our IT section, we build systems that help with resource tracking. So we work with partners to engineer systems that help you track resources, map resources to output. So one good example is a system we built with Ministry of Health. It's called Routine Enhancement Indirect System. That's what we do.
Zambia Paul, PAWL.
Okay, hi everyone. My name is Zia from Zambia Paul. Okay, PAWL. Okay, the business is basically a retail-based pawn business. What pawn actually means is we buy and sell new to second-hand goods and sell them retail with an option of credit. And we also give short-term loans. Our main clientele or our main target market is usually the underbanked and unbanked. So I need more data on that to come up with a structure that can accommodate especially the underbanked, looking at the main goal of financial inclusion. Basically, that's what we do.
Okay. Okay.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Bright Nyundu. I'm from Broadway. If you go in a mall and you see a machine that says this machine does not give change, those are Broadway machines. So you put cash in there, you buy airtime, Zesco, and all that kind of stuff. So we are a payment system. We process payments for different service providers. We have different products, but we're known for those machines. We've got mobile point of sale machines for merchants. We've got an Android app for merchants, and we've got an electronic wallet. All these are designed for the unbanked.
I'm not sure if virtual doctors are here. They're the only ones I think that haven't made it.
They have a telemedicine application. Okay.
Okay, he will explain because they're coming from the same, I think, the group companies.
Yeah, so Virtual Doctors, they're a UK-based organization. They have a telemedicine application where basically at the health facility level, you'd be able to take a picture of an ailment. They would send it to basically a group of doctors that kind of joined this consortium of doctors in the UK, and they basically helped to diagnose at a facility level to support clinical officers.
Great. Okay. So we've come to the end of the session today. The rest of the evening's sessions are between the many of you as you interact. Are there any questions? Yes.
Regarding the us putting down our names, like, is there any limit? Like, do you have to put your name on just under one intake?
Yeah, this one. This one. You want to write your three?
Yeah, write two. One, two, three.
Help me understand why you want to do that.
Because you can't. It might be one. Possible that most people go to one side, and then few people are found on one side. So I don't know, to balance it up, if other people had given the other one as a second option, it would kind of balance up.
That was a good point. My partner tried to shut it down because to extend the time it would take for us to actually get all matched. But if everyone feels that way, then we might as well do it. Does everyone feel that way?
Sorry.
Yes.
Just a question to ask. What would happen for data fellows who have expressed interest way before now?
Okay. As Lukonga, I would allow them to participate in this program as long as they have the right expertise and also they understand the context. Of course, the rules stipulate one thing, but at the end of the day, I would rather we break the rules in order to build a good data science community and also that we are able to do the right types of products. So we can make exceptions only because at the end of the day, we have to meet the goal. And all this can be discussed as case by case, yes. So you want to write at top three? Okay, we'll do that. Any other questions? Okay, no questions.
We listened to the two presentations. Honestly, I was like in a physics class years ago. So personally, I'm a business person. I'm only interested in, okay, what I'm getting from you, how much money is it making me, and how many people am I accessing and stuff like that. I don't know whether you have really put a certain infrastructure in place for, because the question was asked about accessing data, and I really didn't get an answer from that, because we have to be as proactive as possible. This should just be a theory class. What exactly are you putting in place to make sure that we are getting something out of this, not just talking about it, but we're actually getting data that's coming to us that we're using to come up with business decisions?
So there's the aspect of there's data that we cannot access, and if it's not there, there's nothing we can do about it. Then there's the aspect of there is data that's somewhere that some of you may want to access, and that's where we can then begin to engage the people that you feel should provide you with that type of data, which then is a process which you cannot define whether you know we get it tomorrow, or next week, or the other week. That's dependent on who that institution is. But we are hoping that from a technical aspect, the fact that each fintech has been matched with a data expert and is a data fellow, that amongst all these people, you will be able to map some sort of strategy on what to do if there is no data, or what is the data that you can work with to improve or create a product and service. So we don't have all the answers or the data, but we are hoping with the resources that we've been able to put together in this program that you can be able to access particular type of data. FSDZ are willing to share their data. The rest, case by case, we'll see what we can do. But let us know what data you want, and then we can begin to engage whoever has that type of data. Hope I have answered.
Sorry. Maybe just to emphasize on this point, maybe if I understand it correctly, if I get where he's going to with his inquiry, maybe it will help us to solve. Now, for some of us who are fintechs, for instance, Rodby probably has terminals at the station in particular places. So it's easier for us to see an advantage where, case one, Rodby would make its own data available to build value out of that process for data fellow and the data expert to say, is there any way we can optimize the business case? I know why you're looking at me like
that. Oh, okay.
But you get what I mean? So optimize that experience to see whether there's any insights we can glean that they can, for their use, of course, after whatever non-disclosure agreements we sign.
Yeah.
Because my understanding is this, because of our various, the specialty of our various industries, say inventory, say financial institutions, say the consumer space. Obviously, if you're looking at the pockets of data in each of these areas, they are slightly different. So unless maybe from a Bongo Hive data hack collective, we're saying, okay, we can pull all this and then see what we can make out of it. That might be an option. Or something more specific to say, if it is my data, then of course, input I'm not willing to share, which defeats the purpose of this in the first place. So maybe you just provide a bit of guidance as to what really the rules are. Is it open season, or are we limited by the type of industry we're operating with? That sort of thing.
So for that, and we've had this conversation with the I2I organizers. For us, so for I2I, they don't want to touch your data, okay? The complexities that come, you know, you may 2 years from now come back and say, oh, that data that we gave I2I. So from that perspective, they don't want to touch your data. We don't want to touch your data. However, the collaborations between the fintechs can happen, should happen, if you are willing to work together. So we can't impose and say you have to share your data with our probates. But if you feel that you need some data from them within this platform, why not do that? And if you come to us and say, hey, you know, can you, because you broker some of these partnerships, then let's do that. Otherwise, so we won't necessarily impose. This is a very sensitive issue as usual. But of course, you know, the appeal is that if we are going to make this a better place, I guess we should collaborate. Why not? You know, this Bongo Hive, I think, is quite a safe space, so why not do it at Bongo Hive? Why not do it via Bongo Hive? So very willing to help everyone collaborate and things like that. And if that's the spirit, then you know, why not?
I noticed the more fellows than there are fintechs. Is it possible for one fintech to be paid to more than two fellows?
Yes. And some fellows, if you decide you don't want to be paired with any, because at this point you don't understand anything, that's fine as well. If you decide like, hey, this is too much, I can't, I don't like it, that's okay as well. Yeah.
Yeah. And just to add, if you choose to share the data and when there's certain other, because the problem of confidentiality clauses with the customers and things like that, you could, what's the right word? My former colleague.
Anonymous.
You could anonymize the data in such a way that it doesn't lead to you know, disclosing certain financial positions for customers, which would then lead to more complications than so you could be anonymous. Why am I yeah. So that would work. Yeah. Unless you just want people to know the volumes that you're pushing.
Yeah. Any more questions? Okay, so how many fellows are in here? If you can just raise your hand. Okay, good. Does it